Your holy name, I praise your name. Your holy name, I praise your name. Not just today, but always, now and forever. Lord, I praise your name. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Not just today, but always, now and forever. Lord, I praise your name. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Not just today, but always, now and forever. Lord, I praise your name. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Not just today, but always, now and forever. Lord, I praise your name. I praise your name, your holy name. I praise your name, your holy name. I praise your name, not just today, but always, now and forever. Lord, I praise your name. When the praises go up, blessings come down. Praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. Praises go up, blessings come down. Oh, praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. Blessings come down. Blessings come down. Blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. Praises go up, blessings come down. Praises go up, blessings come down. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Your holy name. I praise your name. Not just today, but always, now and forever. Lord, I praise your name. Come on and sing. I praise your name. I praise your name. I praise your name, your holy name. I praise your name. Not just today, but always, now and forever. Lord, I praise your name. When the praises go up, oh, blessings come down. When the praises go up, oh, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, oh, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, oh, blessings come down. Yeah, blessings come down. Oh, blessings come down. Yeah, blessings come down. Oh, blessings come down. Listen, God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you. Oh, yeah. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. Reach up and grab it. Yes, He does. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab 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 it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. When the praises go up, come on. Blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. Oh, when the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, blessings come down. When the praises go up, come on and praise Him. Blessings come down. Oh, praises go up. Blessings come down. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you, Mama. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. God's got a blessing, yes, He does. God's got a blessing, yes, He does. God's got a blessing. God's got a blessing. God's got a blessing. God's got a blessing. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. God's got a blessing for you. Yes, He does. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. You can have it. Reach up and grab it. Not just today, but always. Not just today, but always. Not just today, but always. I praise your name. Come on and praise him. Hallelujah. He's worthy of the praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on and praise him. Hallelujah. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Come on. Hallelujah. Give him the praise right there in your living room, right there in your home, wherever you are. Come on and praise the Lord. Hallelujah. He's deserving of the praise. Hallelujah. He deserves your praise. You deserve the glory and the honor. We lift our hands in worship and we bless your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. We lift our hands in worship and we bless your holy name. You deserve the glory, oh, and the honor. Oh, we lift our hands in worship and we bless your holy name. For you are great. You do miracles so great. You do miracles so great. You are worthy. You the glory and the honor. Lord, we lift our hands in worship and we bless your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor. Oh, we lift our hands in worship and we bless your holy name. For you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. Hallelujah. He's worthy of the praise. He's worthy. Come on and bless the Lord. Hallelujah. We praise you, God. We honor you. You deserve it. You deserve the praise. You deserve the glory. We worship you right now. We worship you this evening. We honor you, God. We praise you, God. We thank you, Lord. We say hallelujah. hallelujah, the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. Hallelujah. We praise you, God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. There's no one else like him. There's no one else like you. There's no one, God. Thank you, Jesus. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, God. Have your way on this evening. Let your will be done in this earth, God. Let your will be done right now. In the name of Jesus, bless your man servant as he comes before your people. Anoint him the more, oh God. Let the anointing flow from the head to every member, God, to everyone watching, to those that are hearing. In the name of Jesus, we pray, God, that you would change lives. We pray, God, that you would lift the burden. We pray, God, that you would heal and deliver and set free on tonight. In the name of Jesus, and we put ourselves in your hands, God, and we give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's read the word of God coming from 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter and the first verse. Let's read that pericope that is really about 12 verses. However, I want to, yes, it's about 12 verses, but I want to read the entire chapter of 2 Thessalonians. I know it's lengthy, but we're studying the Bible. We're studying tonight about the coming of the Antichrist. The coming of the Antichrist. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word nor by letter as from us, as that day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember you not that when I was yet with you, I told you all these things? And now you know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doeth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth, whereunto you are called. He called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which you have been taught, whether by word or our epistle. Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father, which have loved us and have given us the everlasting consolation and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. We're talking about the Antichrist, the coming of the Antichrist that Scripture teaches us, that the Bible teaches is imminent, even in the day that we're living in. 2 Thessalonians, this is pericope I just read for you, this entire chapter that I just read for you is Paul's letter to the Thessalonians. In that very first verse, Paul discloses to the Thessalonians, and if we read it closely, we see that someone has written a letter as if it is written from Paul. They've written a letter to the Thessalonians, and it has disturbed them. This letter has disturbed them, and Paul is telling them that not to be shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word nor by letter as from us. So a letter has been written to the Thessalonians as if it's been written from Paul or the disciples concerning the coming of the Lord. During this time, the church is in so much persecution. So much persecution is going on until they think they are in the great tribulation. They think the Lord must have come, and the Lord has come, and the church has been left. They've been left, and they're disturbed. And Paul is comforting them with these words, and he's letting them know, don't let anyone deceive you. Don't be deceived by this. Before that day comes, the day of the Lord, the day when the Lord comes to judge this earth, to judge the Antichrist, to judge those who have opposed him, to judge people that have opposed the way of righteousness and godliness, there has to be a great falling away. I want you to think about that. Before that happens, there must be a great falling away. People that were standing, at one time, you will see them fall away. People that were once following Christ, living for God, serving God, professing godliness, they fall away from God. Professing more than I'm born again, but following God, living for God. He says that day before the Lord comes, you will see a great falling away as a result of deception, falling away from the faith in God, faith in the Word of God, faith in the promises of God, faith in what the Word of God says about living for God, about holiness, about righteousness, about godliness. You will see people that once embraced godliness, once embraced holy living, once believed in being faithful and living godly, you'll see them falling away. Not just a few, not just a scarce, but a great falling away. The Antichrist, and what this falling away will do, it will open the door and usher in the coming, the revelation of the Antichrist. 1 Timothy 1 and 4 speaks about this falling away from the faith. This opens the door where this worldwide leader, this world has never had a worldwide leader. And in Revelation 13, which is part of the lesson, it talks about this beast coming out of the sea, coming out of the sea, that these horns, seven horns and 10 horns in all together, revealing this, him coming out of all the nations, rising up from all the nations to be a world leader, rising up from the people and being a world leader. Revelation 13 talks about this beast, the Antichrist, rising up. And his revelation comes after a great falling away. 2 Thessalonians 2:1 says, that day will not come. It will not come. The revelation of the Antichrist will not come until there is not just a falling away, a great falling away. And we see that happen. That spirit of Antichrist is already here. John talks about it in 1 John, the second chapter. He talks about the Antichrist has already come, the spirit of Antichrist. We see that spirit. We see that spirit that the Antichrist has, the spirit of Satan. It's already in the earth. We already see it. It's already here. Now, that was 95 A.D. That was like the 11th hour. So it lets us know that the revelation of the Antichrist, it is soon to come. Because even then, in 95 A.D., when the last apostle was alive, John, he saw it. He recognized it. The church saw it. Isaiah 2:12, the Old Testament talks about this day of the Lord. The day of the Lord. Isaiah 2:12 calls it a day of reckoning. The Lord is going to settle all the accounts. The records are going to be settled. The books are going to be opened. Judgment is going to be taken of those who oppose godly living, who oppose God. And I want to say right now, you all, salvation is a very big word. It's a big word. I'll deal with it a little bit more, but it's a big word. Salvation involves more than the being saved from the penalty of sin. The penalty of sin. God wants to save us from the power of sin. Jesus came to take away. He came to save us from our sin. It's not just enough to be saved from the penalty of sin. God wants Christ manifested in our life that we would have power over sin. So much so until he gave us his spirit, the spirit of God, the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will also make alive our mortal bodies, empower our mortal bodies to have authority and power over sin. Praise God. And that's through his word that he does that. Isaiah 2:10, 11, and 12 talks about the judgment that's going to take place against the proud when the Lord comes. The proud, I tell you what, that is the spirit. That's part of the spirit of Antichrist, a proud spirit. That the Antichrist, the spirit of Satan embodying a man, Satan being manifest in a man, just like God was manifested in Christ. God was manifested in a man. Yes, he was manifested in a man, Jesus. God was in Christ, a man. There's one mediator between man and God, the man, Christ Jesus, the man. And Satan is going to be manifested in a man. And we're going to see the wickedness manifested through him. It's going to be great deception. This is the greatest sign that's going to be seen during that day that's even taking place even now. Great deception. Great deception. Zephaniah 1:14. I don't have time to read all those verses, but I just want to call them to your mind and you can go back and study this. Zephaniah 1:14 and 15. Zephaniah 2:2 and 3. I just want to show you the Old Testament speaks about this day of reckoning that's going to come to judge the Antichrist and all those that are following the Antichrist. All those who are following the spirit of the Antichrist, a proud spirit, a proud spirit, a spirit that will not submit to the word of God, a spirit that will not submit to the power of the Holy Ghost. a spirit that will not submit to God's word. This man, this Antichrist in 2 Thessalonians in the second chapter, in the third verse, he's called a man, he's a man of rebellion. Oh, that's the spirit. Now, not only is it a proud spirit that he is going to manifest, but he's a man of rebellion, rebelling against the word of God, rebelling against the law of God, rebelling against the spirit of God, speaking to men, convincing men, calling men out of darkness into the marvelous light. He's a man of rebellion. We see that in Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 25. He was a fallen angel, a high angel, beautiful, intelligent, has power, gifted. But the one thing that he was so proud about, and he was envious of God, all the angels worship God. All the angels, it bothered him with all this beauty he had, all this intelligence that he had, all the gifts that he had, all the responsibility that God had given to him. Everything he had, it was given to him. But one thing that was not given to him was to be worshiped. God is the only being that should be worshiped. Man is not to be worshiped. There's no angel that should be worshiped. There's no person that should be worshiped. There's no institution that should be worshiped. There's no organization that should be worshiped. Nothing that we have attained should be worshiped. God and God alone should be worshiped. And this bothered him. And this is what he's after today. And somehow he seduces man to worship him. We find man worshiping them, and the spirit behind that is the spirit of Satan receiving worship. So much of man spending so much money on it, spending so much time on it, has so much appreciation for it. Say, give so. You know where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. And the spirit behind the thing is Satan. Satan is receiving worship from man through hiding behind different emblems, different logos, different institutions, hiding behind it, and men worshiping that. Giving more time, giving more money, giving their gift, everything that God gave them, using it for that particular institution, person or thing or whatever, instead of giving it to God. I tell you what, all the praise belongs to God. All the praise, all the worship. And I tell you what, it's seen by the way we spend our time and the way we use our money, what we worship. And so he's a man of rebellion. Men, in the fourth verse of 2 Thessalonians, man who exalts himself. He's a man, he exalts himself. That's the spirit. That's the spirit of the Antichrist. God didn't exalt him. He exalted himself. God gave him so much. And instead of giving God praise, giving God thanks, giving God glory, he exalted himself. He exalted himself and wanted to exalt himself above the throne of God. And everything he received it from God. I tell you what, that's a satanic spirit. When we begin to exalt ourselves above men, above people, when it's all said and done, we're dust. When it's all said and done, we're nothing. I know you don't want to be told you're nothing, but when it's all said and done, without God, we have nothing. Without God, we can do nothing. Without God, we know nothing. Without God, we're a zero. We're nothing. But thank God. Thank God. Praise God. His mercy, his love. And Jesus, the Bible says Jesus, he humbled himself. Here he was. He was, even though he was equal with God, he made himself of no reputation. See, that's the spirit of Christ. That's not the spirit of Antichrist. That's the spirit of Christ. He made himself of no reputation. And what did God do? Jesus humbled himself, even unto death. He had to humble himself to death because he did no sin. Neither was guile found in his mouth. And death could not find anything in him. He had to humble himself to death so that death could come after him. He became sin for us. He didn't do no sin. He became sin for us. And he made himself of no reputation. And he became sin for us. Praise God. This, let me tell you something. Christ is everything. Christ is it, y'all. I'm telling you, Christ is it. He humbled himself. We're nothing, and he's everything. And that's the spirit of God. We need to pray for the mind of Christ. That's the kind of mind he had. He gave glory and honor to God. He trusted God. He gave glory and honor to God. And the Bible says that God gave him a name, y'all. Gave him a name. Gave the man, Christ Jesus, a name that's above every name. And I tell you what, you may not bow now, but you're going to bow. If you don't bow to him now, you have an opportunity. If you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior, you have an opportunity to bow to him and confess him as your Lord. Now, this is the truth, y'all. This is the truth. If you don't bow now, you will bow. Because he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. God has given him a name that is above every name. And every knee is going to bow. And every tongue is going to confess that he is Lord. You may not say it now, but one day you're going to confess that he is Lord. But here's the opportunity you have. You have the opportunity to confess him as your Lord, as the Lord of your life. To make him the Lord of your life. Let him rule your life and your life will be better. Let him reign over your life and your life is going to improve. I guarantee you, if you let Christ rule over your life, rule over you, yield to him, trust him with your life. Listen, it is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. Listen, you say, I'm a self-made man. I'm a self-made woman. You didn't make yourself. It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. And we need to exalt him, humble ourselves. I tell you, our problem is we need to get lower. We need to get lower, and we need to lift him higher. Can we just take a moment and lift him up, just a few seconds here, and lift him up? He needs to be lifted higher. Glory to God. And we need to go lower. He's a man. That's the spirit of Antichrist. He's a man. He's who exalts himself. The Antichrist is a man. Christ was a man, but God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. And this Antichrist, one day he's going to take this, take himself in the seat of the temple. There's going to be a temple in Jerusalem right now. It's a mosque, but it's going to be a temple. And he's going to highly exalt himself to the point where he's going to tell the world that he's not just the world leader. He's going to tell the world that I'm God. And you need to worship me. You need to worship me. You need to praise me. You need to worship me. He's going to come into Revelation 13, 1 through 8 talks about that. The temple of God, the Antichrist, is going to sit in that seat. Daniel talks about he's the abomination, and he's going to set his own self up and exalt himself as if he is God. Just like Christ came. He's a counterfeit. He's false, and he's a false Christ. He's a false Christ. He has false preachers. He has false teachers. He has false apostles. He has his whole movement is false. He does signs, wonders, and miracles. He has power to do these things. But the spirit that's behind his power is the power of the Antichrist, is the power of Satan, is the power of that fallen angel, that fallen spiritual being, that fallen angel who is going to embody himself, who's going to live in a man, who's going to dwell in a man and manifest himself as if he is God. And there are many people, many people that are going to operate in his spirit. And they're doing it today. John said in 95 AD, there are many antichrists. Many people running around with that spirit, that false spirit, operating in that false spirit. But here's what John says. He says they were among us, but they were not of us, and they left us because they were never a part of us. In other words, the preaching, the strong preaching. These false antichrists was sitting in the church, was sitting with them in fellowship, was worshiping with them, had offices and had titles with them. But the strong, Jude talks about how they crept in the church, but the strong preaching of the apostles drove them out. The strong preaching of the truth, of the character of Christ and the gospel and the truth, they say, I'm leaving this church. They left. Too much preaching against sin. Too much preaching against ungodliness. Too much preaching against holy living. Unholy living. Too much preaching. That strong preaching from the apostles of holy living and sanctification and godliness and integrity and the character of Christ. It caused them to leave them. And John said, they were never of us. That's why they left us. They were never of us. They went out from us because they were never of us. The preaching of the gospel, the real preaching of why Jesus came to save us from our sins, not to continue in our sins, not to just say, I'm born again and continue in sin. I've confessed Jesus as my Lord and continue in sin. I told you, salvation is a big word. Salvation does not stop at I repented of my sins. Salvation does not end at I've been born again. I confess Jesus as my Lord. The Lord wants to sanctify us. He wants to set us apart from sin. He does not want us to continue in sin. He does not want sin to rule over us anymore. He wants to be Lord of our life. He wants us so much so that he gave us his spirit to dwell on the inside of us. Not just to jump and shout, not just to praise God, have a good time in church, but that spirit is supposed to quicken our mortal bodies, our physical bodies, to live holy, to live godly. He allows us to be tempted. He allows us to be tested. He allows us to be tempted of the devil and overcome temptation and grow in grace and grow in favor with God, to grow in knowledge and favor with God and with man, to overcome the devil by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, to be tempted and to be tested and to grow. And he'll put no temptation on us that we cannot, that's more from us to bear. But with every temptation, there's a way out. There's a way out to hold on to God, to overcome and to grow. And as we grow, as we pass tests, we grow, we get more sanctified. We get more sanctified. We get stronger. Salvation is a big word, you all. And it involves sanctification. Folk want to hardly say now that they're sanctified. They'll just say, yeah, I've been born again, I'm saved. And they laugh and mock at sanctification. But I read for you tonight that we've been chosen. He says, I've chosen you to salvation through sanctification. Sanctification of the Spirit. The Spirit of God wants to sanctify us. When Jesus was filled with the Holy Ghost drove him into the wilderness to be tempted. And when you get filled with the Holy Ghost, he's going to drive you into situations. He's going to drive you into different tests so that you can be sanctified, so that you can exercise your spiritual muscle, so that people can see the character of Christ in our life. The character of Christ, not just who Christ is. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Come on and give God praise tonight. Let me calm down here. The Antichrist will be revealed. We will be revealed. And I pray, this is our prayer, that the spirit of Antichrist is not revealed in us. Praise God. But the spirit of holiness and sanctification would be revealed in us. Not the spirit of Antichrist, not the spirit of rebellion, not the spirit of pride, not the spirit of exaltation, not the spirit of making ourselves more than what we are, not the spirit of making our exalting ourselves above others, but the spirit of Christ, the spirit of humility, the spirit of love that never fails, the character of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Antichrist. There's going to be a man. That's going to, I'm speaking spiritually tonight, but he's going to operate, he's going to rule the world politically. He's going to rule the world economically. He's going to rule, but he's also going to rule religiously. And I say religiously. He's going to operate in the realm of politics. He's going to operate in the realm of economics. And he's going to operate in the realm of the church, the false church, Babylon. The false church, the church that doesn't want to live holy, the church that doesn't want to live godly, the church that says, once saved, I always saved, no matter how I live, I got saved, I'm still drinking all night, I'm still getting high, I'm still smoking dope, I'm still not listening to the Holy Ghost, not being filled with the power of God. The Holy Ghost, come on and say it with me, the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit, a spirit that would dwell in you so that you would grow in holiness, not unholiness, but that you would grow. It's a process. There's a part of salvation that is a process, and it's called sanctification. Sanctification, sanctified. That some of your sanctification, you got to do yourself. Sanctify yourself. Clean up yourself as the Word of God, as you read and look in the Word of God, and it's a mirror, and it shows you yourself. The truth shows you yourself. Clean it up. Bathe in the Spirit of God. Yield to the Holy Ghost. Yield to the Word of God. Yield to what the Word of God says. Clean yourself up by the Spirit of God. Sanctify yourself by the power of God. He gives us the Spirit of God so we can yield to the Spirit of God to be cleansed by the Word of God. Cleanse our mind. Present our bodies to God. Yes, our bodies. God wants to sanctify us wholly, not just in our minds, not just in our spirit, but our whole bodies. He wants our bodies to be sanctified. He wants our hands to be sanctified. He wants our feet to be sanctified. He wants our thoughts to be sanctified. Yes, the Bible says the thoughts of the righteous are right. God wants to save us so until we think right, until we think like God, until our thoughts are right, till we think holy. The thoughts that we have about people are holy thoughts. The thoughts that we have are holy. He wants to sanctify us through his word and through his spirit as we believe the truth. But we got to love the truth, y'all. We got to love the truth. We live in a day where people don't love the truth. And that's going to be the spirit of the Antichrist, where people don't love the truth. They just like things that tickle their ears, think things that just excite them on the outside. But the truth cuts. The truth, it lets you know that it's going to cost you something to obtain the glory of God. It says, whereunto he called you. I'm reading that 14th verse. I know I'm skipping around, I'm trying to exegete, but my time is getting away from me. So I just want to hear, if I said anything, it's some things I definitely want to say. I want to talk about this sanctification, because this is what the Antichrist is about. He's anti-sanctification. He's anti-holiness. He's anti-godliness. He's anti-Christ. He's anti the Christ of God, the holiness of God. So the gospel that he preaches is a gospel that will tickle that you enjoy. You enjoy it while you're in your sins. You enjoy and shout and dance and just have a good say, "Ooh, church was so good," and go back and live the same ungodly, sinful life, not coming out of anything, but and not hearing what the word of God is saying. Come out from among them. There's a group you need to come out of. God saved the. I told you, salvation is a big word. He saves you from something. Not only does he save us from the penalty of sin, the wages of sin is death, But the gift of God is eternal life, but he wants to sanctify us and call us, set us apart. We can't run with everybody. We can't look at everything. We can't do everything. Make a difference. Make a difference between clean. There's a such thing as clean living, holy living, godly living, sanctification. He wants us to be involved in that process. And that's the work of the Holy Ghost. That's the work of the Word of God to work in us. We're part of a new group. It's called the church, the real church. The church, it's a price. It's a price to be sanctified. It's a price to obtain the glory of Christ. See that word obtain, to obtain, that's not free. To obtain, to gain something, if you gain something, to make an A in something, teachers, real teachers, are not just giving out A's. They don't just give you an A, you have to earn an A. You have to work for an A. You have to do the work. You say, oh, salvation is not work. That's why I don't like them holiness churches. They preach works and works, and salvation is free. Yes, being born again, it is free. Being filled with the Holy Ghost, God would give you. It's a gift of God, being filled with the Holy Ghost. But to be sanctified, it's going to cost you something. Yes, your flesh don't want to be sanctified. Yes, your flesh don't want to be saved. Yes, your flesh don't want to live godly. He don't want to live holy. He don't want to obey the will of God. But God gives us the Holy Ghost so that we can, so we can deny our flesh. Yes, so we can take up the cross and follow him, so we can deny ourselves and tell our flesh no, to obtain the glory. What is the glory? What is the glory? The glory is not us, it's Christ. So that Christ could be seen in our life, to obtain it, to gain it, to gain it, to gain it. We got to pay a price. We got to pay a price. We got to yield. We got to give up some things. We got to come out of some things. We got to make a difference between clean and unholy. We got to clean and unclean, holy and unholy. There is a difference, and you do it. You make the difference. God is putting on us. If you love the truth, if you love this truth, if you love this gospel, if you love him, or are you going to just continue to have pleasure in unrighteousness? The Bible said that Moses, when he realized what God had called him to and the assignment that God had called him to, and I'll tell you what, our assignment is to live holy. Our assignment is to live holy right here in this present world. The Bible says he forsook Egypt. Yes, you got to forsook him. Instead of being in Egypt, where he was there in Egypt, living in the palace, living in pleasure, eating the dainties, running in the big crowd, positioning himself to be the next Pharaoh one day, living among delicacies. The Bible says when he found out who he was, he forsook Egypt. And he said, and he made a decision, I'm going to forsake Egypt, and I'm not going to sit around here and enjoy the pleasures of sin. Yes, sin is pleasurable. Sin is a good time. I'm not going to lie to you about it. Sin is a lot of fun. But the Bible says it's only for a season. That's what the devil tricks you. The devil is tricking you. It's not going to be always like that. God is going to judge sin. Thank God for a preacher that would tell you the truth. You're going to thank God for people that preach to you and told you the truth, that you need to come out of your sins, that you need to change your lifestyle, that you need to change direction, and not just say, yes, but I'm born again. Stop judging me. I'm saved. I accepted the Lord back in 2000 and 2005. I even got filled with the Holy Ghost, and I spoke in tongues and everything. But you're enjoying the pleasures of sin. Your life is centered around pleasing yourself. Your life is centered around enjoying the pleasures of sin and fulfilling the lust of your flesh, giving your flesh everything he wants, when he wants it, how he wants it. And your flesh is never satisfied. Matter of fact, it's like things that when you did get saved and you were taught holiness, you came out of things, you're like a dog that's returned to his vomit. You're going right back to that stuff, and you're waddling in it, and God called you out of that stuff. Come on, it's time to wake up. Wake up. Come to yourself. You've been deceived. You've been tricked. You've been tricked by some false prophets. You've been tricked by some people that are full of the wrong spirit that's telling you it don't take all that. And it does take that. Yeah, it does. The pleasures of sin. Look what it says here. I read it for you. They that might be damned who believe not the truth. You don't want to believe what I'm saying? Because you want to hold on to your unrighteous living. You want to hold on to your ungodly living. You want to hold on to your ungodly lifestyle that the word of God preaches against, that is not like Christ. That lifestyle, people can't even see Christ. The lifestyle that you're living, people can't even know Christ. The lifestyle that they're living, they don't see Christ. They see you. They see you. They see you drunk. They see you high. They see you cussing. They see you acting a fool. They see you acting ungodly. But somebody, you're not a city that setteth upon a hill. We're supposed to be a city. We're supposed to be the salt of the earth. We're supposed to be preserving people. We're supposed to be keeping the spirit of Antichrist infiltrating the lives and hearts of people. We're supposed to be preserving the world. People should be living because of us. We're not supposed to be immersed in the world. We're supposed to come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. He is a counterfeit. That's what the Antichrist is. Don't you want to be real? He's a counterfeit. He's a counterfeit Christ. He's Satan. Christ was God incarnate, God in the flesh. And the Antichrist is Satan. He is that fallen angel. That fallen archangel that was created to worship God. And he loves worship, but he loves worship for himself. That's who Satan is. And he is, and he's going to be incarnate in a man. That man is going to do supernatural things. Because there's two supernatural powers in the world, and that's God and Satan. And one thing God did not do, he did not take away Satan's supernatural power. Let me tell you, do not be deceived by all these signs, miracles, and wonders. Don't be deceived by them. Because Satan is going to use signs, miracles, and wonders to deceive so many people. I want you to look at Deuteronomy. I found this scripture here. I've taught on this before. But just look at, turn with me to Deuteronomy 13. This is a scripture, because we live in a day where people are just enamored with signs, miracles, and wonders. They think this is the key. They think this is the key to revival in the church. They think this is the key, signs, miracles, and wonders. I'm telling you, the key to the to revival in the church is the word of God. You got to love the word of God. You got to love God's word. You got to love the truth. The truth about sanctification, the truth about holiness, the truth about godliness. You need to love it and not be in love with signs, miracles, and wonders. And we have, there's so many people today, they are so in love with the supernatural. I tell you what, if you want to just see a bunch of supernatural, go to some of these heathen countries. Man, they're doing some bizarre things. Oh, yeah. And the church is just as, many churches are just as deceived as in some of these heathen countries that are really ignorant. They're really ignorant, and we shouldn't be that ignorant sitting up in the church hearing the word of God and having Bibles and being able to read Bibles. That's why God's going to really be hard on so many people in the church, because we should know better. And where heathen countries are really being deceived and used by evil spirits to do supernatural things. I mean, floating in the air and just doing all kind of things, and we want to see those things in the church. We want to see that. We want to see so many supernatural signs and wonders, and that's the thing. That's the thing. When the apostles and disciples asked Jesus, "Show us what's going to be the sign of your coming? What's going to be the sign of your coming? You know, the day of the Lord, when you come back, to bring judgment on this world. When you come back, what's going to be the sign?" He says, don't be deceived. Beware of deception. That's the sign. It's going to be great deception. Look at Deuteronomy 13. He says, 13 and 1. If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and giveth thee a sign or a wonder. And the signs or the wonder, they come to pass. They happen. I mean, it happens. You saw the sign. You saw the wonder. It happened. Wherefore, he spake unto them, saying, but wherefore he spake unto them, now let's go after other gods. Now, the same person that did these signs and wonders, your attachment to them, they lead you into a carnal lifestyle to go after other gods. So I mean, it's very subtle. It's very subtle. The lifestyle that they live, look at their character and stop being so caught up in the signs and wonders and miracles that they're doing. Watch their character. Like people, like priests, like people. Look at their character. They're leading you into a carnal lifestyle, a worldly lifestyle, a life of pleasure and not a life of sacrificial living, not a life of holiness, not a life of godliness, not a life of humility, not a life of integrity, not a life of honesty, but a life of money, material things, loving material things, loving money, going after money so until you don't have time for our Bible study. Love pleasure, love movies so much, love drinking and clubbing so much. Look at the time you spend there, but you don't have time to spend in the things of God. And they tell you, and they're immersed in those things themselves, but they do signs and then miracles. You find yourself saying, yeah, I know people say, I know this person does this, and yeah, I know it's true they do that, but man, I went to their church, and my God, I tell you what, there was signs, and there was a move of God. Yeah, but what God was it? Was it the God that says, be ye holy, that Peter talks about? The God that says, be ye holy, for I am holy. Was it that God that's calling you to holy? Was it that God that do they lead you to holiness, to righteousness of God? But no, after being in their midst, you find yourself going after other gods which thou hast not known, and let us serve them. I know that it seems so subtle. It's saying, but I'm not serving them where your treasure is. You don't even give to the church. You don't even support the work of God. You don't even love the word of God. Don't tell them you love the work of God. Your treasure shows whether you love the work of God. That, well, I can tell what you love by looking at your bank account, by looking at what you write checks for, by looking at what you say. Your treasure tells the story, what you love. I can tell whether you really love your wife, if you are paying the rent, if you paying the overhead, if what you pay for. Your love speaks volume. Your treasure. That's what your heart is. How you spend your treasure. But when it comes to the things of God, you don't have the money for it. You don't have the time for it. You don't have. And then they will use that. They'll turn it, which thou hast not known. And let us serve them. Then it says, thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet. Don't you listen to their words. Don't you listen to their words or that dreamer of dreams. Let me tell you what the Lord is doing. You say, well, God, why would you let their prophecies come to pass? Why would you sit back and let the miracles? Why are all these signs and wonders happening if they're not of you? He says, because the Lord's testing you. He's testing you to see if you love the truth more than signs, miracles, and wonders. What do you love? Do you love the word of God? Do you love the word of God? Can you just sit and listen to God's word? No miracles took place. No signs took place. No, none of that took place but God's word. Somebody told you the truth about holiness and godliness. And no signs, no blinded eyes open up. The deaf didn't hear. The lame didn't walk. None of that happened. But they told you the truth. They told you you need to come out from among them. They told you you need to come out of some things. They told you you need to get out from among that crowd. They told you you backslidden and you need to come back to God. They told you that you're going in the wrong direction and you need to start following Christ and obeying the word of God. They told you that. But you didn't love the truth. You love the sign. You wanted to be entertained. You love the signs and miracles and wonders. You love the music. You love the entertainment. You love all the vision. You love everything that was carnal, that was the physical. But you did not want to adhere to the word of holiness. You love the pleasure, everything that gives your flesh pleasure. It was just another pleasurable experience, but it was not an experience that challenged you to come out from among them and be ye holy, saith the Lord. Oh, my time's almost up here, but I'm trying to talk to you about apostasy. Before the Antichrist comes, you all do not get caught up in the great wave of apostasy that is going to sweep the church. And I'm telling you, it's taking place right now, a great falling away. Paul says there's going to be a great falling away. I mean, examine yourself. Look, he talks about it in Revelation. I mean, look where you have fallen. Look where you've fallen. Where you've lost your first love. That's what's going to happen in the coming of the Antichrist. People are going to lose their first love, their love for God, their love for holiness, their love for living for God, their love for putting God first, seeking first the kingdom of God, the spiritual kingdom. Don't even seek all these material things. Let God add them. Let God add what? Trust God to add what you need. Trust God to do it. Delight yourself in the Lord. Let him give you the desires of your heart. Your heart's desire ought to be a hunger and a thirst for righteousness, the ways of God. Righteousness is the ways of God. The way of God is holiness. There's going to be a way there. It's called the way of holiness. It's a wayfaring man. Few, you're only going to find a few there. It's gates. It's two gates. Wide is the gate. Broad is the way, but it leads to destruction. It leads to destruction, but narrow is the way, and straight is the gate that leads to life. Come on and tell God thank you. I'm getting happy here tonight, and I'm trying to hold on. But the church, we must not lose our salt. We must not lose our salt, church. Oh, God is counting on the church to be the light of the world. To be that city that sits upon a hill. When we lose our light, that we become just like the world, and the world don't see us as a light. That means that we've fallen away. There was a time when people saw something in you. They saw Christ all in that your life. Do you remember that song? Christ all in my life. In everything I do, they would watch you. Even when there was a time you used to pray over your food, wherever you were, you didn't care who saw you, who was there, whether you were at an expensive restaurant or just a little hole in the wall. You took some time out and you didn't try to say a little quick prayer, but you were thankful for what God did in your life, and you would take some time out, and there was something about your prayer when you would be out with your people up on the job. It was something about when you prayed over the food. They could feel the Holy Ghost even in your prayer. Sometimes you'd get caught up sometimes and not just pray for the food, but pray for somebody. There's somebody at this table that's about to eat this food, and God will give you a revelation about a need in their life. And not only do you pray for the food, I know what you're saying. Say, nah, you're trying to be deep, but you know that God will use you because you gave yourself to God. That wasn't the first time that you prayed that day when you said the blessings over your food, but you were not ashamed of the gospel. Come on, tell the Lord thank you. We're not ashamed of the gospel because it is the power. I'm telling you, the church, we got to get our power back. We got to get our power back. Not just a form of godliness. The Antichrist is going to have a form of godliness. He's going to look godly. He's going to talk godly. He's going to act godly. But he's not going to be like God. He's going to have a form of godliness. And everybody that follows him is going to have a form of godliness. But what makes the church is not a form. It's not the form. It's not because we know how to clap our hands.
hands. It's not because we know how to sing and dance, shout, speak in some tongues, but it's a power. It's the power. Come on and say, it's the power of the Holy Ghost. It's the power that enables us to live a holy life. It's the power that God gives us to say no to sin. I don't want to sin. I'm not going to sin. I'm not going to yield to this temptation because I love the truth. God, help me. Help me to stand. Help me to stand. And when I've done all to stand, I want to stand. Therefore, I see the spirit behind this. I see the spirit of the enemy. He doesn't want me to live holy. He doesn't want me to live godly. But I hear the Lord saying, be holy as I am holy. I want you to be like your daddy. Be like your daddy. Don't be like the Antichrist. His daddy is the devil. He's a thief. He's a robber. He's a liar. He's been a murderer from the very beginning. He ain't no good. But Jesus, he is the good shepherd. Where he leads me, I will follow. Follow him. Follow him up through the valley. Follow him up through the storms. Follow him up with pain in your body. Follow him up when your bank account gets low. Follow him in the impossible, because with God, all things are possible. Follow him. Put the devil under your feet. Put the devil behind you when he gets in your face. Tell the devil, get behind Satan. You savor is not the things of God. You don't have an appetite for the things of God. You don't love the things of God. You don't love holiness. You don't love righteousness. You don't love worshiping God. You don't love that God is my refuge. God is my fortress. God is my very present help. God is the lifting up my head. Thank you, Jesus. Let's give him glory. Let's give God the glory. Come on, let's glorify him. Jesus is mine. Mine. He's mine. He's mine. I gotta close, y'all. The Holy Ghost, y'all, is what's restraining the Antichrist from coming forth. Because you got the Holy Ghost. Because he's got people here in the earth full of the Holy Ghost. It's restraining. That's the only power that's stopping the Holy Ghost, the Antichrist from manifesting himself. Because the Holy Ghost is here. Come on and thank God for the Holy Ghost. Jesus said that, listen, I'm going to leave, but don't be afraid. If I don't leave, the Comforter will not come. But when he comes, he's going to lead you. He's going to guide you. He's going to keep you from being deceived. He's the Spirit of truth. He's the promise of the Father. He's going to take you over. You need to yield to him. You need to recognize him. And I'm telling you, he's for your children and your children's children. Your children need the Holy Ghost. Our children's children need the Holy Ghost. People that are a long ways off from God, all you need is a good baptism, is a good immersion of the Holy Ghost. And I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost will change you on the inside. He'll make you that new creature where old things are passed away. And behold, all things have become new. Come on and tell the Lord, thank you. I got to close, y'all. I got way too happy here. I'm going to read this, you all. I'm going to read this. The Antichrist, Revelation 13, reveals that he's going to come for 42 months. I'm telling you, he's a fake, y'all. He's going to be here. Jesus' ministry was 42 months, you all. He lived here for 30 years, and then he announced his ministry. And one day, the Antichrist may be here now, but one day he's going to come forth and announce he's going to be manifest. He's going to announce his ministry. And lets us know in Revelation it's going to be for 42 months, just like Jesus when he announced his ministry. That's 3.5 years. Jesus was here 3.5 years after the age of 30, after he announced his ministry. And one of the things the Antichrist is going to do, he's going to have people working for him, and it's going to be a lot of signs, miracles, and wonders going on. And it's going to deceive so many people. And God is going to give a strong delusion because people don't want to believe the truth about holiness and about godliness. God is going to allow people to believe a lie, to believe they're saved and they're not saved, to believe they have the Holy Ghost and not have the Holy Ghost, to believe they have a gift of the Holy Ghost and really don't have a gift of the Holy Ghost. It's a gift, but it's not of the Holy Ghost. Even doing things in the name of Jesus, they're going to be deceived, so deceived, until they're going to tell Jesus, what do you mean? What do you mean I'm not saved? What do you mean? What do you mean I'm going to be lost? He says, I never even knew you. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. You did it. You did it and thought you could continue in iniquity. You did signs and wonders and thought you could continue in iniquity and that not mean anything. You did things in my name and still live in sin and in iniquity and in godliness and tried to claim that you are part of me and I never even knew you. Depart from me, you worker. You are a worker. You are a worker of iniquity. He said, he's the lawless one. He's the spirit. You didn't want to be subject to any of my laws. You did not want to be subject to any of my commands. You did not want to be subject to my word. You did not, and you led other people astray while you did it. You would not submit to my word. The Antichrist, he is the man of sin, preaching against sin. When the Antichrist comes, I tell you, that spirit is here now. Preaching against sin is unpopular. People don't want to hear a preacher preaching against sin. It's all right to preach against. I mean, it's going to be a whole generation. I'll tell you what, we have a generation like that today. They call it judging. They call it just being too hard. They call it, I don't enjoy him. He don't encourage people. I'm trying to encourage people to come out of sin. His word is just not encouraging enough. Somebody need to encourage you to stop sinning. That God didn't just call you just to be born again and say, I'm saved. You're supposed to get out of the sinning business. God gave us all this power to have over sin, to have over ungodliness. He gave us power over sin. That's the kind of encouragement you really need. There's a generation. Preaching against sin is not popular because it's just not entertaining enough. Because we love our sins. John says they loved unrighteousness. Love it, love it, love it. They love the pleasures of unrighteousness. Told you Moses said he forsook Egypt. You got to forsake some things if you're going to get sanctified. He forsook unrighteousness. And said, I'd rather suffer affliction with the people of God. Holiness require they that live godly. They that live godly will suffer. Will suffer. He said, I'd rather suffer affliction with the people of God than enjoy the pleasures of sin. I'm telling you, it's for a season. And when the season ends, it's judgment day. It's only for a season. We need to be careful about preaching. When I preach, and even as preachers, we need to be careful when our preaching is dominated by social inequality. We're just preaching about the social equality in the world, inequality, preaching about racism, preaching about caring for the poor. We can't let people put some guilt trip on us. Oh, they ain't doing that. They don't help the poor enough. And Jesus, he checked that kind of stuff. Jesus didn't let them put that on him. He said, listen, you're going to have the poor with you always. You're not going to always have me. Somebody need to preach Christ and him crucified, the sufferings of Christ, holiness. You're always going to have the poor. I don't care how much you help the poor. You need to help the ungodly. Find the way of holiness. A education, all kind of good things. Preaching when it's a time of a crisis in people's life, when like COVID and pandemics and all our messages become about the pandemic. Listen, people going to hell during the pandemic, but people need to know what holiness is, what godliness is. We still got to preach Christ. We got to preach against sin, catastrophes. Our voice should be heard, and we need to preach what Jesus came to do. He came to save us, y'all, from our sins. Sins that Jesus speaks of. If you read the Matthew 5, 6, and 7, Jesus, the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus speaks against so many things. Y'all, I got to close this message. But listen, I wanted to get all the way to the 17th verse. But 2 Thessalonians 2 and 7 is seen as a false grace that assures people that they are eternally secure. Eternally secure just because they once accepted Christ. That's a lie. That's what the devil told Eve. He told Eve that you're not going to die just because you disobey God, just because you live a life of disobedience. You're not going to die. Just accept him as your Lord and live the way you want to live. You're not going to die in sin. You're not going to be judged. You're not going to have to worry. You're not going to be concerned about that. That's a lie. That's the big lie. That's the big lie that the Antichrist is sending out and still perpetuating today. That you shall not surely die. Despite the fact that they continue to live in sin, this kind of preaching, it tickles the ears of people. Therefore, many people, they love to listen to it. Just praise them anyhow. Just thank God. Live whatever kind of live, instead of going through the process of sanctification. Revelation 13. The rule of the Antichrist, in Revelation 13, I'm closing this out. The rule of the Antichrist is described as we are told that he gives his followers an option. They can follow him publicly or secretly. It talks about in Revelation 13 that they can receive the mark in their forehead or they can receive it privately in the palm of their right hand. To serve him secretly and keep their reputation. Yes, yeah. You don't want people to know that you save and sanctify and live holy and live a godly life. You want to be hypocritical and not let people know that you've given your life to Jesus. You're really living an unholy and ungodly life. But Revelation 14, the people of God. That were in the tribulation, they had no option. You had to have the mark of the Lamb in your forehead. Either you're going to serve God publicly or not at all. You cannot be a secret servant Christian. Either you're going to make it known and you're going to live what you teach and walk what this word says or not at all. There is no option. Christ in us, the hope of glory. You know what, you all? I got way more gospel here than I have. I'm sorry, I can't exegete all of this tonight. I'm just gonna stop. I'm gonna stop. A loose attitude towards sin, the Antichrist, a looseness about sin, a looseness. Living in a day, we have to be very careful about the supernatural. Yeah, just play Sonny Stephen. I'm closing this out. Salvation is a big word. It's a big word. It's a great big word. This preacher, you said a lot tonight. I tell you what, when God gets involved into deceiving us, there's no hope. We need God on our side, y'all.
I'm telling you, get on the side of the truth. Get on the side of holy preaching, holy teaching. People say, yeah, see, that's why I left that holiness church. That's why I don't like that church. Church I go to, we club, we go to clubs, we smoking, we drinking. Preacher don't be getting all in our business. he don't bother us. He just preach the word. I tell you what, if the preacher is preaching the word, he's going to preach the life of Christ, the character of Christ, holiness, sanctification, the process, hating unrighteousness, and loving righteousness. We're chosen for this, you all. 13th verse says, God have from the beginning chosen you. From the beginning of time, from the beginning, he chose you to salvation through sanctification. Not just being born again, that's the beginning. Being born again is the beginning. Maybe somebody never told you that. Maybe they just told you, accept the Lord as your Savior, and you're saved, and you got eternal life, and you're going to heaven, and whatever. But they never told you that God called you to holiness. That your salvation, he chose us for a salvation that is through sanctification of the Spirit. Cleansing of the Spirit. It's a process. I'm not saying you get there overnight. No one gains it all in this lifetime. But you need to grow more in sanctification. You need to grow from the day that you first were saved. Yeah, you're supposed to grow. Just like you grow physically in your physical body. And then it gets a point where you come to church and you fed the word of God, you're a baby, your pastor, he teach you the word of God, then you need to start exercising your spiritual muscles. Exercising your spiritual man. Wanting God. Seeking God. Realizing that there's more. There's more. So many people want to know so many things about the end times. They want to know about the signs, the beasts, the symbols and all this, but they don't want to know about the price, the call to holiness, the life. They don't want to discuss that part. They want to debate about all the mysteries, but the mystery of iniquity is about Satan spreading a message that you can continue in sin and still be saved. Amen. He deceived Eve like that. That's the big lie. That's the mystery. The mystery of godliness in 1 Timothy 3:16, God was manifested in the flesh. The mystery of iniquity is Satan is manifested in the flesh. Which one is going to be manifested in your flesh? Satan or God? If it's God, you're going to manifest holiness. If it's Satan, we're going to manifest iniquity. Mystery of godliness and the mystery of iniquity. Don't believe the lie. Don't believe the lie. Don't believe the lie. Shall we continue in sin and say I'm under grace? And grace abound? God forbid. Sin shall no longer reign over you. Reign over your mortal body. Father, I want to thank you tonight. There's many antichrists tonight. This world we're living in. Forgive me, Father, for not getting through all of this, but my heart is that someone tonight would not believe the lie that's spoken of in the 11th verse of this of this lesson tonight. The lie that if God does not intervene, open the eyes of our understanding and make us see. The lie that we need God to protect us from. And that God, that we will not be one of the recipients of this strong delusion that's going to be come forth, that you're going to send in the earth, that people would believe a lie. Because we love unrighteousness so much. But because sin is pleasing our flesh so much. Lord, help us today. Help that man or woman today who's convicted by this word tonight. Who at one time loved the truth. Who embraced holiness. Who came out from some things. Who made sacrifices to live holy. And now they're fallen. But you love them so much that you sent your word. Thank you, Father. Man, come out from among them tonight. Just make a break. Don't do it gradually. Make a clean break. Yes, there's some friends you just need to make a clean break from. Get them out of your contacts. Don't go over their house anymore. Don't call them anymore. Don't text them anymore. They say they haven't heard from them. Say, listen, I was backslidden. I wasn't doing you no good. Oh, man, you wasn't backslidden. I'm saved too. Yeah, what do you mean? No. Make a break. Make a break for them. You know what's right. You got deceived. God's opening your eyes tonight. Come on back. Come on back to prayer. Some of y'all during this pandemic, you flat out done backslid and using for an excuse. It ain't even that you afraid of catching COVID. You need to stop using that excuse anymore. You just don't even want to go to church. You've lost your love. You've fallen. No accountability to God. No accountability to leadership. Rebellion in your heart, saying, I do what I want to do. I don't need nobody to tell me what to do, and I don't need to be accountable to nobody. I don't need to respect nobody. I serve God. Let me tell you, God is the God of protocol. Let me tell you, God is a God of protocol. Don't ever think you're so special. You're so special that you don't have to hear man. That God is not going to have you to be subject to somebody. Jesus was subject. I said Jesus was subject. Told John. John said, I shouldn't be baptizing you. He says, no. All righteousness needs to be fulfilled. This is the way God has designed it. He's designed for me to submit myself to you. And you baptize me. Glory to God. Told Paul, the greatest apostle, greatest writer in the New Testament, told him, go see a man named Ananias. He's going to tell you what to do. Paul, the scholar, the man that spoke different languages, the man that sat under the leadership of one of the best teachers of his day, submit to Ananias. And scales will fall off your eyes. And you're going to begin to see spiritual things. And you're going to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Glory to God. And God is going to show you the things that you must suffer for his name's sake. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Come on back. Come on back to holiness. Come back to righteousness. Come back. Come back. Repent. Turn. Turn from your wicked ways. Wicked ways. Come on. Wicked ways that come from the wicked one. Thank you, Jesus. Come on and love the truth. Love the truth. You shall know the truth. Truth to make you free. Got habits that no one knows about. Got iniquity in your life. Shouting and running in church, speaking in tongues and everything, but full of iniquity. Thank you, Jesus. Repent. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. Don't exalt yourself to be something you're not, to be more than what you are. Let him exalt you in due time. I thank you, Father. Somebody's hearing me tonight. Oh, yeah. I feel you. I tell you what, I feel the virtue coming out of me, Gray. I ain't saying I'm Jesus, but I can sense when the Holy Ghost is contacting folk. Anybody in ministry know that? You know when the Holy Ghost, you know when somebody's pulling on the anointing. That's why it's hard for me to close tonight. You know when somebody, any preachers out there, any evangelists out there, any ministers out there, you know when somebody's pulling on your anointing. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I'm staying on these extra few minutes for you. Thank you, God. Tell him yes tonight. Lift your hands and tell God, thank you. And so, Lord, fill me with your spirit. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. I once knew you. I once knew you in the power of your resurrection. Thank you, God. I want to know you like that in the fellowship of your sufferings. Thank you, God. Save me. Fill me tonight with your spirit. God bless you. The Lord loves you. He loves you. And he wants to do a deep work, not just a shallow work, a deep work in your life. Thank you, Father. Come on, let's launch out into the deep, in the deepness of the Spirit of God, in the Word of God, in the things of God. You're getting ready to catch a draught. Come on, you've been fishing on the wrong side. Come on, let's throw our net on the right side. God already has what you need. Glory to God. Bring in a drought. What you're going to bring in really is for somebody else. Because the closer you come to Jesus, you're going to find out he already has what you need. He already has what you were fishing for. He's already prepared it, praise God. Come on and sit with him and dine and eat. And let him reveal to you the plan that he has for your life. My God, tonight, I'm preaching tonight. Let me stop here. Glory to God. God has a great plan for your life. My brother, my sister, and mother. Praise God. The way is the way of holiness. Holiness is right. Don't let anybody fool you. It's more than a church title. It's more than a religion. It's not a religion. It is a real relationship. It's a change. It's a sacrifice. There's a price to pay to obtain the glory that's in Christ Jesus. God bless you all. Y'all, we're going to be back on Thursday night. Thursday night, we have candidates here from the city that are running for the city council. They're going to be here Thursday night at 7 o'clock. So when you see us pop up on Thursday night, that's what's going to be happening. We pray every day, though, at 6 a.m. We pray every day at 6 a.m. You can join us in the prayer. Somebody joined us this morning. I didn't even know they had our prayer line number. But you know what? That's what hunger do for you. That's what thirst will do for you. You'll find. You will find what you need. You'll find what you need. You'll find a way. They that hunger and thirst for righteousness. See, this thing is worth searching for, going after. If you really want the Lord, come after him. Deny yourself. Take up the cross and follow him. He that loses his life, loses the pleasures of this life, loses the things that gives him pleasure, you're going to find life. You're going to find the real life. And he that just finds the things that gives him pleasure, you're going to lose the real thing. The real thing is Christ in us, the hope of glory. See you on Thursday night. Join us in our candidate forum. But most of all, see you this Sunday morning. It's coming Sunday, 9 a.m. First Lady brings forth the word of God. I was talking about her this past Sunday. First Lady, I appreciate her ministry. I appreciate the time she spends in ministering to you the word of God. Thank God for her. Join us at 9 a.m. and 12 noon. We're back. We're here at church, and I admit people aren't coming back the way I want them to. And I'll be honest, the way they should. God's been dealing with people by coming back, and they're rebelling. They're rebelling. Some are rebelling. Some are being deceived. And some really shouldn't come. And I respect that. But there's so many others going so many other places and has just replaced worship and coming to the house of God and has become so loose in their living. And you need to ponder the path of life. Think about it. Ponder it. Let's get back to our assignments. Let's make sure we fulfill. Take heed. Let's be careful that we fulfill the call that God has placed in our life. Bless you all. I love you. I'm anointed here tonight. I'm gonna have to continue this discussion about the Antichrist and the millennium and the great tribulation that we're on. I wish I could get with some people that love to talk about this stuff and just sit down and talk about this. This stuff is good. This stuff is good. You read the 13th chapter of Revelation and I don't know how you can read those verses about the Antichrist, the millennium, and the great tribulation, and don't get fooled. You just got to talk. You got to talk to somebody. Praise God. You just can't walk around with all this stuff. I love you all. Y'all know our motto. Come and go with us, and we will do you good. Now unto him who's doing exceeding abundantly above all that we can even ask or think, according to the power that is working in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. God bless you. Come on and say amen, amen, amen. So be it. Bless you all. Amen.